Let us stand and turn 53rd chapter of Isaiah. So, let's read together. Who had believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness. And when we shall see him, there's no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteem him not. Surely he has borne our griefs, carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He's brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he openeth not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment. And who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgression of my people was he stricken. And he made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see of the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. God bless your heart. Our meditation this morning is by Sister Ida Green. Let us hear her as she comes to give us what God has given to her.
Let us pray. Oh God, we just want to say thank you. God, we thank you for this day. Yes. Realizing, God, that it was all because of your grace and your mercy and your love. And God, we thank you. And then, God, we thank you for another opportunity just to come out here to praise you and worship you for who you are. And now, God, we need to hear a word from you. Let your word go forth in this house. Send down your Holy Ghost power and don't let any of us leave here like we came. And now, God, I just ask you to just take Ida out of self, hide her behind the cross, so they only can see you and not me. And I promise you, I give you all the glory, because you share your glory with no one. And now, Lord, if you don't do anything else for us, you did enough on Calvary. This is my prayer, and I pray it in no other name but Jesus, the name that one day every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Amen. Amen. Will you help me praise God from whom all blessings flow? I know it's early, but he deserves all our praise. On Monday, Reverend Feeling spoke on the greatest prayer that would ever pray. But I come to let you know this morning that it's praying time. And if Jesus took the time out to pray, what about you and I? Even while hanging on the cross, Jesus prayed, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." So my first question to you is, how does your prayer life look? Are you praying on a daily basis, or do you just pray when you're desperate and need something from God? And then when you pray, are you persistent in your prayer? See, because persistence means not giving up. So do you pray until something happens? Do you pray until that situation or circumstance change? Do you pray until you get your healing? Do you pray until that loved one gets saved? Do you pray until you get your breakthrough? You see, some of us give up too easy when God is silent, when we are waiting on an answer from God. But I come to let you know that sometimes God puts us in a holding pattern. And see, when you're in a holding pattern, you don't see no progress or change. You just gotta wait on God. And I know many of us have a problem with waiting because we want a right now answer. But I want you to know I don't mind waiting on him, because I know in my waiting, God is working that thing out for my good. And we know all things work together for the good to those who love God and to those who are called according to his purpose. People, there is power in prayer. I know what prayer can do, and I know prayer works, because God has allowed me to live to become a living testimony to the power of prayer. Yes. You see, y'all, I'm standing here today because somebody took the time out to pray for me when I was too foolish to pray for myself. Yes. And I thank God for the intercessor. But most of all, I thank God for my personal intercessor, Jesus Christ, who is at the right hand of God, pleading for all of us today. So don't you ever underestimate the power of prayer, because the prayer of a righteous man, y'all, is powerful and it's effective. And we must start lifting each other up in prayer. We have too many Christians walking around here beat up, broken down, living defeated lives when God has already given us the victory over 2,000 years ago on a hill called Calvary. See, y'all, when I look at the cross, I don't see defeat, I see victory. And I don't know about you, but I'm feeling the victory down in my spirit this morning. And I'm declaring victory in every area of my life. Yeah. So no matter what come up against me today, victory is mine. Victory is mine. Victory today is mine. People, it's time for us to start walking in victory. You know, prayer is the most difficult exercise in a Christian life. But oh, what a privilege it is. Y'all, it's a privilege purchased by the blood of Jesus Christ. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. People, I read in the word that we could come boldly to the throne of grace. Therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter the holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which he consecrated for us through the veil, that is his flesh, let us draw near to God. Yes. Prayer is entering into the most holy place in the very presence of God. Now, in the Old Testament time, only certain priests could go into the holy place. And then there was a thick curtain that separated the holy place from the most holy place. Yes. No one except the high priest could go into the most holy place, and that was only once a year to pray for his sins and the sins of the people. Yes. But praise God today, we don't need a priest or pope to pray on our behalf. Yes. You see, I don't know about you, but there's some sins that I have committed that only needs to be between me and the Almighty God. Yes. Because he was the one that paid a debt that you and I couldn't pay. Yes. He canceled out our certificate of death and nailed it to the cross. Yes. And I'm so glad today that through Christ we can go straight into the most holy place. Into the very presence of our Heavenly Father. People, there is no power greater than that which comes through prayer. Yes. Prayer is one of the most powerful weapons God has given us. Yes. See, little prayer, you're going to have little power. Much prayer, you're going to have much power. You know, sometimes in this life, some rain going to fall on all of us. You will come against some situations and circumstances that will knock you to your knees. Yes. And when that happens, you better know how to call upon the name of the Lord. But I just want y'all, when you're going through, just remember, better days is gonna come, all because he got up. So don't you lose hope, because y'all, hope has a name, and his name is Jesus Christ. My hope, your hope, is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. On Christ, the solid rock I stand. All other ground is seeking sand. Now, can I tell you again that it's praying time? If you don't believe me, just take a look at what's happening around us. Y'all, this world is full of pain and suffering. Come on, take a walk with me as we go through our communities and see the problems we facing. Y'all, we have black-on-black crimes. We have gangs. We have war on drugs. We have incarceration. 1 out of every 4 black males are incarcerated. We have families being destroyed because of gambling addiction. We have single parents trying to raise children. We got children out there trying to take care of children. Y'all, we have mothers against daughters, daughters against mothers. We have domestic violence on the rise. We got teen pregnancy on the rise. We got suicides among our black males on the rise. We have HIV among our black women on the rise. We have our kids being bullied at schools. We have our kids being molested and abused by adults. We have kids starting young and young engaging in homosexuality activities. Yeah, we have the city of Baton Rouge, #1 in the nation in AIDS. People, I'm just trying to tell you it's praying time. And we need to wake up. How can you be a Christian and not pray with all this here going around in our communities? Y'all, then we had a president of the United States of America who would rather spend over $5 billion to build a wall. And we have over 500,000 homeless people living right here in America. Wake up, y'all, it's praying time. Now, can I bring it closer home to
bring
you?
It on home, baby.
Take a look at what's happening in the body of Christ. We have discouragement, depression, downtrodden, defeated, divorces on the rise. Y'all, we have hatred, we got jealousy, we got backbiting, we got envy, we got bitterness, we got lust, we got pride right here in the church. But I read in his word, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from my wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and heal their land. People, we need the Lord like we never needed him before. It's time for us to join forces and call upon the name of the Lord together. You see, we need a mighty move of God to take place right now. We need his power, y'all. We need his anointing to sweep through our churches, sweep through our homes, sweep through our communities, and through this United States of America, because it's the anointing that destroys the yoke. Church, would you help me call upon the name of the Lord this morning? Because something happened when you call on that name. Now, I don't know what you might call him. Somebody over here might call him your bright in the morning star. Somebody over here might call him the lily of the valley. Somebody back there might call him the everlasting father. Somebody up there might call him the first and the last. But I just call him Jesus, the man that walks with me, the man that talks with me, the man that tells me that I'm his own. Really matter what you call him. You just need to call him up and tell him what you want. Y'all, his line is never too busy. Has anybody in here ever tried him? 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 See, y'all, I done tried him and he answered. You know why I tried him? Because I have seen the lightning flash. I have heard the thunder roll. I have felt sin's breakers dashing, trying to conquer my soul. But I heard the voice of Jesus telling Ida still to fight on. See, y'all, he promised never to leave me, never to leave me alone. Amen.
Amen. It is praying time, amen. Thank you, Sister Ida Green, for that wonderful devotional message this morning. Amen. That'll wake you up. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord. bless us, dear. Lord bless. Good morning, good morning. What a blessing again to get up early in the morning and to hear such wonderful words and to worship the Lord. Let us stand. God sent his son. They call him Jesus. Let's lift our voices and give God praise. He came to love. Of the St. John Baptist Church in Dorsetville, Louisiana, that great metropolis across the river. So happy to have him. He's my friend. Be grateful. But before he comes, I'll have my friend, Sister Nancy, who I love to hear sing. Amen. So let's pray for her as she comes this morning. And after we hear from Sister Nancy, next voice will be that of Pastor Gregory Coates. Amen. Amen.
The blood that Jesus shed for me blood, the 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 blood, that gives me strength from day to day, to day, to day. Yes, it will never, 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 never. Never, never, never lose. Never, never, never. Never, 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 never. Never, 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 never lose. Never gonna lose this power. Somebody lift your hand and say never. Somebody wave to the Lord and say thank you for never. Come on, somebody lift your voice and say thank you for never. It will never, it will never, it will never.
Infinite love, you in whom we live and move and have our being, O Lord our God, how excellent is your name in all the earth. Lord, thank you for allowing us this opportunity to see this moment on this slice of geography. Oh Lord, just our very presence in your sanctuary says so much about your love for us. Lord, it says first that you loved us enough to watch over us all night long. Lord, thank you for angels that you just camped to be around our bedside. And then God, as we drifted off to dreamland, Lord, at the right moment you stretched forth your hand. You gathered our wandering thoughts, brought them back into compliance, and touched us with your finger of love to allow us to wake and clothe and in our right mind. Oh, thank you, Lord. Then we've got to moving around, God, and discovered we had the activity of some limbs. Lord, thank you for all of your goodness toward us. And then, Lord, you allowed us to have this opportunity to lift our voices unto the God of our salvation. And now, Lord, I, your servant, come before you, realizing my insufficiencies and my lack of ability, and I just put myself in your hands. Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be found acceptable in your sight, you who are my strength and our Redeemer. Lord, please touch our ears and our hearts that we might be prepared for that which you have to say to your people today. Oh Lord, I present myself before you as an empty pitcher before a full fountain and ask that you would just pour into me and let it overflow. Lord, run out and touch all of us. For we know that if you would just touch us, we'll leave this place better than when we came. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, give the Lord a just because hand. To my good friend, whom I have admired and loved and looked up to over years, Pastor Cyrus, it's good to be here. Even this early in the morning, it's still It's still good to be here. Amen. I was so excited to look out in the congregation and see so many of my classmates and friends, and so many of you who have supported me over the years when we used to get together on Fridays at Shiloh. Anybody remember that? Amen. I'm glad I ain't the only one that's then got old. Speaking of old, I was wondering about this lineup. You know, because I was the senior citizen. He back there talking about it right now. And I was thinking he thought I was still young. And if he did, that's why I love him so much. Amen. I wish you would consider my assignment today, which is Calvary. And I looked at this thought, Calvary, and looked over in the gospel as it's been recorded by Luke. Chapter 23. In verses 26 through 33. Reading from the New American Standard, you'd find these words. You should sign some similar, depending on the version in which you're reading. It says, "And when they led him away, they seized a man, Simon of Cyrene, coming in from the country, and placed on him the cross to carry behind Jesus. And following him was a large crowd of people and of a woman who were mourning and lamenting him. But Jesus, turning to them, said, 'Daughters of Jerusalem, stop weeping for me. But weep for yourselves and for your children. For behold, the days are coming when they will say, Blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed. Then they will begin to say to the mountains, Fall on us, and to the hills, cover us. For if they do these things when the tree is green, what will happen when it is dry?' Two others who were criminals were being led away to be put to death with him. When they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified him and the criminals, one on the right and the other on the left." You may be seated in his presence. My thought: lead me to Calvary. The thought that I offer up today is a verbal contradiction. For the reality of what Calvary was should make it a place where nobody with good sense would want to go. The words read that they came to the place called the Skull. Matthew tells us in his gospel that in the Hebrew, this was named Golgotha. In our title, I have referred to it by its Latin form, which is Calvary. Calvary is the place where crosses are lined up, the emblem of suffering and heartache. Calvary is where one's enemies gather as spectators, with you as the spectacle to watch your imminent destruction and demise. Calvary is the place where the light should shine in your life suddenly goes out. Calvary is the place where your loved ones gather to suffer with you because they want to help you, but there's nothing that they can do. Calvary is the place where your feet get nailed down and your hands are tied. Calvary is the place where you get lied on, talked about, and mistreated. Calvary is the place where justice goes to die righteousness is overcome by wickedness. Wisdom is overcome by wickedness. And dreams and visions are hung out to die. I repeat, no one with good sense should want to go to Calvary. Well, you can count me among the crazy. Because I still contend to you today, lead me to Calvary. Now, before you count me out and say I ain't gonna mess with that crazy boy, let me give you the reasons for asking you to lead me to Calvary. Reason number one, it's what real Christians do. That's the reason number one. Reason number one, it is what real Christians do. I opened this with the story that a man from Cyrene named Simon was compelled. Luke was very meticulous when he put his gospel together about every word that he used when he was writing this to the most excellent Theophilus. I consider the words of the narrative in the verse 26 to show you just how much you need to pay attention to what Luke writes. Here's what he says. When they led him away, they seized a man, Simon of Cyrene. Let me back up because I need you to get an order that's fallen in verse 26. When they led him away, they seized a man, Simon of Cyrene, coming in from the country, and placed on him the cross to carry behind Jesus. They led Jesus, but after the cross, they get behind Jesus. Oh, I wish somebody get what I'm saying in here today. Must Jesus bear the cross alone and all the world go free? No, no, no. There is a cross for everyone, and there's a cross for me, there's a cross for you. All saints must be cross carriers. If any man shall come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and now you got to get like Simon, you got to get behind him and follow. Y'all still here? The place you take crosses is to Calvary. So I say to you again, lead me to Calvary. Now that leads me to my second reason that I say lead me to Calvary. There is deliverance from guilt and shame at Calvary. Am I doing all right yet? Now, if you've been right all your days on this point, you can get a little more sleep, because this ain't gonna mean nothing to you. But if there is any like me who have done some things, stay woke. I got good news. The guilty who won't change can find it at Calvary. Oh, I know I'm right about it. I saw it in the text there where the two others walking behind Jesus as they are led to Calvary. Listen to verse 32. Listen to this. Two others also who were criminals were being led away to be put to death with him. This word speaks of an absence of grace. There were two criminals following him to Calvary. Because of the unrighteousness, they were getting what they deserve. Now don't talk about me, don't talk about me, because I ain't messing with them boys like that. One of them said it himself.
I was reading it. I looked over, and here's how it reads. It says, one of the criminals who were hung there was hurling abuses at him, saying, are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us. But the other answered and rebuking him, do you not even fear God? Wow. Now watch this. Since you are under the same sentence of combination, and we indeed are suffering justly, for we are receiving what we deserve for our deeds. The boy just told it on himself. Did you hear it? I ain't make it up. I ain't talking about nobody. He told it on himself. We are getting what we deserve. And he's right, because he's being put to death. And the wages of sin is death. I wish somebody heard me in here. Now, if getting what we don't deserve is grace, then getting what you deserve denotes an absence of grace. But that changes when it's Jesus that's leading you to Calvary. Let me show you what happened. One of them showed up on his own and tried to get salvation on his own terms. If you who you say you are, get yourself down from here. And why are you doing it? You might as well get us down too. And I need you to understand that whenever you approach the throne of grace with an if in your sentence, what you're trying to do is get you some salvation on your own terms, which means you didn't come to Calvary on your own. And I got to tell you, unless Jesus leads the way, you're going to mess that thing up. See, it was on the other one. See, that other one who was on the cross said, grace is available. I see it for myself. Now, I ain't got no reason to even ask you for this, Jesus. But when you come into your kingdom, would you just remember me? After he made his request, here's what happens when you come to Jesus humbly. Grace broke out. Oh, I wish somebody was listening to me up in here. Grace just bust out. Jesus quit dying and forgot about that fellow with that foolishness, looked over at the other boy and said, today, oh, ain't he all right? I used to hear Big Mama say, and while you still calling, he'll send the answer. I got any believers in here today? It is at Calvary that Jesus meets us, reminds us that he took all of our sins away, because Jesus gives deliverance for guilt and shame at Calvary. I'm declaring again, lead me to Calvary. Now let me slip two more in right quickly if I can before I have to sit down. Reason number three, I'm taught how to deal with the ignorance in my life at Calvary. Now, if you've never had any ignorance in your life, you can remain asleep too. But if you have had some ignorance in your life, have you noticed that ignorance that comes in your life is usually delivered by people? Now, I just want you to take a few minutes. Let me see. Yeah, take a few minutes and listen to this logic, because I need you to see if anybody identify with me. Now, you ain't got to agree with me, but just listen and see if you can identify. I get mail delivered to my house. The person who delivers it, I call the mailman. Now, he is a man. That's why I call him the male man. Somebody else might get theirs from a male lady. But I get mine from the male man. And what he does is he delivers mail. Now, I have this great fondness for Amazon. Y'all pray for me. See, because I know today for me, I don't care what the weatherman says, it's going to be a good day. I walked in the sanctuary. I hadn't worn this suit in a while, but I figured I should look pretty when I come to New Hope. So now, I was feeling, patting my pocket, and I felt something in there and reached in there, and I had some money in there. I ain't know what's in this pocket. I ain't wore this suit so long. And look, I got real excited because I looked to see it was, and it was some fives and tens, y'all. It's going to be a good day. And I just realized I messed up. I shouldn't have said that when my wife was in here. Listen. So I got this fondness. I got this fondness for Amazon, y'all. I likes to shop. So I have many parcels delivered to the house. And normally the persons that deliver it is UPS, which stands for United Parcel Service. And they're called that because they deliver parcels. Now listen to my logic. You don't have to agree with it, but at least hear me out. I want to ask a question. If you call the person who delivers your mail, the mailman or the mail lady. If you call the people who deliver your parcels, United Parcel Service, what do you call people who bring that ignorance in your life? Now, I'm not as nice as some of y'all. I call them people ignorant. Oh, I wish somebody would hear me in here today. Now, ignorant basically means lacking knowledge. That is, they just don't know. If you've got some ignorant people in your life, delivering ignorance in your life, you need to cry out, lead me to Calvary. See, it was at Calvary that Jesus taught me how to deal with the ignorant people in my life. He showed me that the best thing you can do when it comes to ignorant folk in your life is pray for them. Oh, that woke somebody up that was sleeping in here. Consider his actions on Calvary in verses 33 through 37. When they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified him and the criminals, one on the right and the other on the left. But Jesus was saying, Father, yes, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Did you see what Jesus had on his ignorant folk all around him, talking about him, whipped him all night long? But look at how Jesus deals with ignorant folk in his life. Watch him now. He didn't give them peace of his mind. He didn't seek no vengeance. He didn't wag no finger at him, talking about, you're acting like that now, but just wait a minute. No, all he did was he prayed for the ignorant people in his life. I'm trying to tell somebody, quit going around trying to get after ignorant people in your life. Quit trying to get even with ignorant folk. Because in order to get even with ignorant folk means you got to get on their level. And on their level might be less than you are. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. So quit trying to return the ignorance you've received by giving them pieces of your mind. Instead, follow Jesus to Calvary
And when you get there, turn them over to him. He can work it out. Oh, I got just one more reason. I'm getting out of here. I'm letting you go to work. Even though I know some of y'all got the call yesterday, you ain't got to come in. I see you rejoicing. Somebody came here today just to say, thank you, Jesus. I ain't got to go to work today. All right, come back with me. Well, I almost lost the crowd that time. Reason number four, that you can lead me to Calvary, the blood. The fourth reason that you can lead me to Calvary is the blood. Watch this, see, in the book of John, the disciple whom was the eyewitness, the one who stayed there for the entire thing, the one that was closest to Jesus in life and closest to Jesus in his death. This is what he said happened in his gospel. So the soldiers came, broke the legs of the first man and of the other who were crucified with him. But coming to Jesus, when they saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one of the soldiers pierced him in his side, and immediately blood and water came streaming down. Oh, I came to tell somebody, lead me to Calvary, because at Calvary there is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunge beneath its flow and wash all of their sins away. I wonder if there's anybody at New Hope this morning ever get into situations in life where you feel like you need a little more power. When I get that way, here's what I say, lead me to Calvary, because I found out there's blood at Calvary. And can I tell you about the blood? It will never lose its power. So when I'm weak, he's strong. When I'm falling, he props me. When I'm leaning, when I'm breaking, he builds up where I'm torn down. Can I ask y'all a question? Ain't he all right? I came to tell you, because I'm not that good. I'm not that perfect. I don't always walk right. Don't always talk white. But if you should see me and I'm not walking right, if you should see me and I'm not talking right, don't talk about me to my neighbor. Don't drag for me down the streets. Instead, if you a Christian, since you on your way, would you just lead me to Calvary? Because the blood can wash me. The blood can cleanse me. The blood can change me. The blood can do what no other power can do. If you believe it, say yeah. Say yeah, say yeah, say yeah. Lead me, lead me, lead me to Calvary. Because if I could just get to Calvary, there's grace at Calvary. There's mercy at Calvary. There is understanding at Calvary. There's change at Calvary. There is power at Calvary, because Jesus always meets me at Calvary. Oh, if you got that word, you ought to bless him today. You ought to just thank him for Calvary this morning, where Jesus washed all of our sins away. Oh, God bless you. Thank y'all for listening. Thank you.
story is told of a missionary who traveled to a remote area of Africa with the hope of spreading the gospel, the good news, to inhabitants that had never heard it. In order to get to the village, he had to cross a river. It was a river that presented fear to the inhabitants of this village, and they had never once set foot in this lake. He said to them, in order to be saved, you've got to go with me to the other side. And they said to him, no, preacher, we're too afraid. We won't cross the river. So after pondering for a moment, he said, I know what I'll do. I'll step out in the river to show them there's no danger. And so he did. He stepped out and he said, see, you can come. And they said, no, we're too afraid. So he goes out further and the water's at his waist and he beckons for them to come and they still refuse. They're standing there on the banks and he just continues to go further and further out until finally he is completely submerged. Now they're really afraid and they are convinced that he has been destroyed. He's died because he's in the river. When suddenly to their amazement, they see him rise on the other side. And he says to them, come, there is no danger in the water. More than 2,000 years ago, the Son had a conversation with the Father and said to them, let me go down. I'll show them the way. And so he came. But he didn't come in the way they expected him to come. And yet he said, come, there is no danger in this water. And they said, no, we've heard others proclaim it, and yet we've seen the way they lived, and we're not convinced that there's any safety there. And so he steps out and he shows them that he has power over the storm, and they're impressed, but they won't follow him. And then finally he calls a man from the grave, and still they won't believe. And so he says, I know what I'll do. He puts a cross on his shoulder, carries it to Calvary, and there he's nailed to the tree and dies. Now they say, we really know it's over now. He's dead. There is no hope. But Sunday morning, yes, he got up saying, see, there is no danger in the water. Come. That's your invitation today.